Tonight on Telescope, Ken Dryden, a student of the game.
Of all the great goalkeepers I've seen, I think Dryden reminds me more of Bill Dernan than any other goalkeeper I can remember. The style was the same, their appearances very similar, and his style was so effective, that is Dernan's, and Dryden even almost sounded alike as well as look alike. And I think that if Dryden can keep this up for a couple of years, he's going to be classified as perhaps the greatest goalkeeper of his time. But like Bobby Orr, he needs time to prove it.
Hockey is very important to me. I think it has to be when you spend as much time as you do in practices and games and so on. But I think that what you must keep in mind is that you should put what you're doing in perspective. The fact that you are playing in something that really is just sort of entertainment, and that there are other things to do, and there are other things that are more significant, that have more of an effect, a lasting effect on other people.
I think the way to describe Dryden is to say that he's a very refreshing personality. He loves hockey, but he doesn't permit hockey to dominate his life. He doesn't permit it to permeate every phase of his being. You know, we've all heard coaches say that the real pros have to think hockey, they have to breathe hockey 24 hours a day. Well, that isn't true. And of course, Dryden and a number of other outstanding players have shown that it isn't true.
I have many motivations for playing hockey. And I think the first and the prime motivating factor is just enjoyment of playing the game. And certainly another factor that I find very interesting and enjoyable about hockey is the fact that it provides a very flexible lifestyle. Certainly the amount of money that you can realize playing hockey at this moment is greater than I could realize in any other kind of job. But it doesn't take much money for us to live on, and in a way, that's a really good thing, because it, not necessarily that it ends up saving money or whatever, but provides you a certain flexibility that when that day comes, when you no longer want to play hockey, when you are forced or decide to choose another occupation, which inevitably will pay that much less, you won't have the feeling of being locked in to doing something that you don't want to do, just because the salary is that much greater.
He used to be very tight with his money. Now that he's got so much of it, he doesn't have to be as tight anymore. But he still tends to be a little bit sticky sometimes. One of the last times I went into Montreal, I expected him to take me out for a steak dinner, and he took me to Harvey's for hamburgers instead. During the summer when we get together, we like to get in as many games of tennis as possible. When I was about 22 and Ken was about 16, he all of a sudden started to beat me in everything. Tennis was one of the games in which he excelled, and I just couldn't seem to beat him at all. We like to play tennis a lot because it's a good reflex game and it's good for goaltenders. Finally this year, I beat him in tennis for the first time in a long time.
Many people get a wrong impression of Ken because he does appear so calm on the ice, but actually Ken, underneath that calm exterior, is very excited. Anything that interests him does excite him. Books, sports on TV, watching the World Series. It's really neat to watch a person that has involved himself in sports, yet he can watch a football game or the World Series. And like, he's more excited, it seems, at that instant about that particular sport than he is about his own.
As a hockey player, I think that we'd have sort of ambivalent feelings about the state of professional hockey at this time. Very selfishly, it's great for the player because there are an increased number of teams so that you have a better opportunity for finding a job. In addition, the salaries are that much higher. And so you gain in that manner too. But at the same time, you suffer in that you only play the best teams a couple of times. And when you have those games so rarely, oftentimes you just have a feeling that, you know, what are you playing for? But you know, I think the person that's suffering most from it all, of course, is the fan. He's becoming slightly disenchanted, especially in cities like Toronto and Montreal, where the teams have always been great, and they've always had the great rivalries with Chicago and Boston and New York and so on. But the only way anything can be done is if the fan calls a halt and says, it's not worth it for me to spend $7 or $8 to see a game. As soon as he starts giving up his season tickets, that's the time that the fan will be listened to.